All right, ready? Oh, okay. Well, good morning and welcome. Welcome. My name is Dennis Rowcliffe, and I'm a member of the Board of Trustees. It's good to have you with us this morning here at First Unitarian of Oakland. I want to make a special welcome to the new members, people who are joining the church this morning. I also want to welcome Shauna, who is sitting in the back, who I just met a few minutes ago. Maybe one day she'll see fit to join our church as well. As a congregation, we strive to be an integral and involved, well-connected part of the city that surrounds us, and to be an inclusive and an anti-oppressive religious community. You are welcome here. If you are new here, we'd like to begin to get to know you. To help us do so, we invite you to fill out an orange newcomer card. Those cards are available either at the greeter's table in the foyer up there, or at the welcome table in Vente Hall, the room next to this one. That newcomer card is also available on our website at uuoakland.org. Doing this helps us to help you explore what our community offers and to find ways to participate. After the service today, Emily Stilper will be holding a 10-minute orientation for newcomers. Look for Emily down in front of the pulpit here to take that opportunity and to get answers to whatever initial questions you may have. Welcome, everyone. I'll read the land acknowledgement. We acknowledge the land and its peoples who belong to this land, the Lejeune Ohlone peoples. Our church institutions and homes are occupying their lands, ancestral and current. We acknowledge that the lands were stolen from the Ohlone peoples, who have an ancestral relationship with the land, the plants, the animals, and the water for millennia, continuous to the present day. Ohlone people are still here. In solidarity with all indigenous people and their right to self-determination and justice, we commit to working toward accountability of the theft, dispossession, and resulting trauma Native peoples continue to face. We commit to being active planners, partners, toward the healing of the intergenerational trauma which persists to this day. Amen. So may we live. And I'll conclude my long speech here with three announcements. One, please join us in Vente Hall after the service to celebrate our new members at the monthly community potluck right there next door. Even if you didn't bring food, you're still welcome to eat. There's usually plenty for everybody. This coming Saturday at 11 a.m., our church will be hosting the one-year launch anniversary celebration of Bay Area's drum, which stands for Diverse Revolutionary Unitarian Universalist Multicultural Ministries for Black, Indigenous, and People of Color. For more information, see the Chalice Chatter, which is our weekly newsletter, or contact the church office. And third, join us for a special celebration service on Sunday, May 19th at 4 p.m., when this congregation will ordain longtime church member and leader Claire Eustace to Unitarian Universalist Ministry. The service and reception are open to everyone, but they are asking for RSVPs so they have an idea how many people are coming. Please see the information posted in Vente Hall for how to RSVP and to volunteer to help. We hope to see you there.
Thanks, Dennis. And Dennis failed to mention, but I believe there is going to be cake after the service also, just in case you needed a little more. Oh, he says he's going to keep it all from himself. Sorry, too late. So we start our services by lighting our chalice, symbol of Unitarian Universalism since World War II, I believe. We will say the words together, and if you know the hand motions, you can follow along with those also. We light this chalice, symbol of Unitarian Universalism. May it remind us of the divine. In all of creation, the power of love to heal what is broken and to be grateful for life's blessings each day. In the Jewish calendar, we're right in the middle of Passover. One of the rituals of Passover is to recall a litany of plagues that God is said to have rained on Egypt thousands of years ago during the Jews' enslavement there, including, among other things, locusts and frogs falling from the sky. Today, the players have different names, and the plagues come in other forms: war, famine, and racism. And we no longer see these plagues as coming from the heavens. Rather, we know they are human-made. And as humans, it is up to us to confront and defeat them, to create the change our world calls for. And so we light our peace candle and Black Lives Matter candles each week in remembrance, conviction, and belief in a better future and in our part in making that future real. As we light the peace candle, let us say together, peace is possible. And as we light the Black Lives Matter candle, let us say together, Black Lives Matter. Each week we come here to this place with something to give and something we hope to find. Often it's some of each. We give joy, friendship, and welcome. We seek comfort, delight, and encouragement. This exchange is community, and it is what we are called to. May this service be an offering of delights, a place of welcome, a community for all. And together we say, come, let us worship together. And now we will sing hymn number 318, We Would Be One. You may stand as you are willing and able.
We now have one of my very favorite ceremonies of the whole year. It's an ingathering. We have 10 new members who have... And so first I would like to call up Dennis, our board treasurer, and Maria, who is the chair of our connections team, our community connections. Woo-hoo. And so for you new members, this is an important step in the journey of your life. And we are so delighted that you have chosen to join this community. So what's going to happen is I'm going to call you up one by one. And first, let me say that three of our new members, so Jody, if you can do the slide, we have Tracy Hickey and Orhan, who are actually in Palo Alto today at the UU Church. Some of you may remember that Orhan and Bella back in January did a service about youth power, about activism, our young people who are doing climate action, climate activism work. So they are in Palo Alto. And then Reverend Ben Myers is preaching somewhere else. But he is a member. He considers this his spiritual home. So they'll probably be part of a ceremony sometime next year. So we usually have two, is the tradition of this congregation. I think we had 7 new members join in the fall. And now today we're going to welcome some more. So first I'm going to call up Ingrid. Ingrid back there. And what I want you to each do is to welcome them. So Leela, you don't have on, you always have such fancy shoes. So this is, and your son didn't come today? Okay. So what I want you to do is to say really loud, and especially kids, say, welcome Ingrid and welcome Leela. Welcome Ingrid. Welcome, Leela. And now, do you want to say anything about why you decided to join?
Good morning, everyone. So again, I'm Ingrid Severson-Tondre, Leela Tondre. And so many reasons, but I want to give credit to an old friend, Cara Andrade, who introduced me to this church back when we were in our 20s. So it was a good 20 years ago. And that was back in my era of spiritual shopping, and I had then become more of a Buddhist for the past 15 years or so, and I felt a calling to just come back to this place I remember 20 years ago that had welcomed me so warmly in a place that just felt like family. It was a place I could bring my kids to join, and I'll just say that when I think about what this Unitarian Universalist Church brings to me, it's just in deep alignment with so much of what I believe in and who I believe I am, and also falls in alignment with like Buddhist principles of right thought, right action, right speech, thought, speech, and action. and just how this community is really creating a beloved community, which we all need so much. And it just brings me a lot of peace and hope and faith. And I love the music. And so I think the pop-up choir and all the beautiful rituals and practices that the FUCO brings us. So it's an honor, and thank you.
Well, so welcome. And here, step over, and Maria will give you a gift. And stay up here because we're going to do the covenantal. That's one of the essence of the ceremony, is to make promises to each other. So as you join our covenantal community, we'll see pretty soon. Okay, and next I would like to call up, why don't David and Jill, you come up at the same time.
If I say something wrong.
Well, yeah, exactly. I've heard about you, David. So this is... So let's first welcome David Conrad and say, welcome, David.
Welcome, David.
And then Jill Bowers, his wife. Welcome, Jill. So do you want to say a little something?
Sure. I was raised a Unitarian. I've been to a lot of Unitarian churches. This is not the only one. This is not the only community. You are part of a larger community, and I think we all have a common goal. You can reach out to other churches. You can use this as a springboard for your own growth and for your pursuit of community justice and growth.
Thank you. Thank you, David. Do you want to say something? No. So he said it all? Oh, well, so say something.
I started in Unitarian Universalism as a kid in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and carried it with me through some adventures in LRY in our teens. It's where we got to know each other.
Liberal and religious youth.
Yes.
Notorious.
Notorious. You can ask for stories later. And then when I moved to Minnesota for grad school, I explored the church there, and after finishing school, I was joined by David in that area, and we got married in the UU Church in Minneapolis by Corin Arisian. Mm. I know some others have been there, too. And then the last 30-some years, we were in the Sunnyvale Fellowship, raising our kids through that program, and we recently moved to Oakland, so I'm excited to join this community. It's really warm and growing, which is fun.
It is fun. All right, so welcome you two, and you can step over and get your gifts. And so next, Maria. So just go ahead and stand over here. So let's say welcome to Maria.
Welcome
Maria. So you want to say a few words about why you decided to join?
I became a UU when I was 41 on a cold Minnesota day, and I just was moved to walk to First Unitarian Society and discovered that half the people there were my colleagues in work and in the arts, and so it was meant to be. But since then, I've moved three times. And each time when I've looked for a new spiritual community, it has been about what is the community and is there wise, compassionate spiritual leadership? Yeah. When I came last year, started coming, the anxiety, transitional anxiety in this church was palpable. And I thought, oh dear. And but in the year I've been coming, I've learned that undergirding that transitional issues and concerns was such a deep integrity and courageousness of search for a reinvigoration, for a re-identity, that I thought, this is not a community that I'm going to just be able to slip in and settle in. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but that it was a vital, dynamic landscape within which I can be challenged and supported and continue to grow. And so I am so grateful and blessed that I've found you guys, that I found us. And I'm so looking forward to getting to know all of you better and to continue being here. Thank you with the warmth and compassion and grace that you have welcomed me for this year. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Maria. And here you can step and get a gift. And so now, I would like to invite up Mike and Sabrina and Everett and Zoe. So come on up, folks. So let's give a warm welcome. Let's do them one by one. So welcome, Sabrina.
Welcome, Sabrina.
And welcome, Mike.
Welcome, Mike.
And welcome, Everett.
Welcome, Everett.
And welcome, Zoe.
Welcome, Zoe.
We we are so happy that you're here. And we love it. So when I first joined, I had, how old are you? That's how old Marcus was when he first came here. And now he's a minister at UC Berkeley. And we had another littler one. So you better just watch out. They may become ministers. So do you want to say a few words about why you joined?
Yeah, thank you so much for welcoming us. We feel really honored to be here. Like others here, I grew up Unitarian. I hear I was the first baby in the Napa congregation when my mom joined it. My grandmother was really active in the Unitarian Redwood City Church. And like many Unitarians, I feel like for 20 years I strayed. I found spirituality elsewhere. And by the time the kids came along, we were like, we're ready to come home. And we've been coming intermittently for about a year. And it, like others have said, it just felt like a great fit for us. So thank you.
Thanks, Sabrina. And want to hand it to Mike?
Sure. Hi. So I grew up sort of Catholic, and I hated church because I started getting, I had to go to it. I didn't go until I was like 8 or something, and so by that time I was kind of like, you know, what is this? And when Sabrina and I got married and had kids, I started to feel like, you know, we wanted to do something, and she started taking me to her to the Unitarian community in Napa. We went a couple times, and I just thought it was an interesting idea to start to maybe, you know, do something spiritual with the kids, do a church of some sort, and it seemed like a good fit.
Kids.
And then, but I wasn't that sure, you know. And then we came here, and I just saw how much the kids loved it and how accepting it was and how different it was from the church experience of my youth. And last time we came a couple weeks ago, I'm not sure exactly what was going on in terms of what was happening up here, but Sabrina just started crying, and she wouldn't tell me why. Mm. And a couple hours later she said, you know, it just the war in Gaza was just, you know, on her mind and just got to her at that moment. And I was like, this is why this is good. Yeah. Because, you know, you need to cry sometimes about things, and this is a good place to do it if you have to. So
yeah.
That really cemented it for me, and I'm glad to be here.
Thank you. Yeah, those tears. Yeah, thank you so much. You want to say something? Uh-oh. You want to say hi, Zoe?
You want to say hi to the community?
Hi.
Hi. And you want to say hi, Everett? Do you want to hold the mic?
Hi.
Okay. So you can get your gifts and then join the others over here. We're almost ready to do our covenant. And so Amy? So Amy, come on up. So let us welcome Amy. Welcome, Amy. So do you want to say why you've chosen to join us?
Sure. There's a theme here. I grew up in New York, in White Plains, New York, and went to a UU congregation as a teen, and then just didn't really have a lot of interest, I guess, for the middle part of my life, and now as the mom to a 5-year-old, similar story, looking for a congregation that would feel like the right fit, and I've been so impressed with Jeff and the program that he's putting together for the youth, and so grateful to meet other families who are like-minded. So we're looking forward to more time.
Yes. Well, welcome. So what we're going to do now is to create some promises among us. Do you want to come up? So let me address you. As new members of the First Unitarian Church of Oakland, do you join our covenant to promote the principles of Unitarian Universalism? And do you accept the differences among us as opportunities for growth? And will you contribute your time, talent, and treasure as you are able toward building a beloved community within and beyond these walls? And by the way, I sent this language to each of the new members ahead of time so that they knew what it was that they were entering into. I thought that was important. And so now you, the congregation, Do you welcome these new members into our community? And do you pledge to help them grow in a sense of belonging as they take their place among us?
Yes, we do.
I think they mean it. Dennis?
On behalf of the Board of Trustees, it's my privilege to welcome you as the newest members of the First Unitarian Church of Oakland. We hope you find with us a place where you can both nurture your spirit and be a part of healing the world.
Ours is an open-hearted religious community which honors the past, envisions the future, and lives with passion in the present. We are an open-minded community of seekers. We invite you to bring your stories of vulnerability and strength, of joy and sorrow, of doubt and faith. We invite your questions and pledge to support you as you live into the answers you seek. Together, let me give somebody
congregation
and to serve in the work of justice, peace, and hope.
Today, we dedicate ourselves to our vision to build a radically inclusive community, to grow the beloved community by expanding the welcome table and deepening our commitments to countering oppression as an intentional, multiracial, multicultural, multigenerational congregation. We will work and play together to create in our congregation a model of our vision for the larger world to be the change we want to see. In the spirit of love and freedom, we reaffirm our commitment with one another. May the relationships we have recognized today be a source of growth, strength, courage, and joy to all. All right, thank you so much. And if anyone asks you what Unitarian Universalism is, in a nutshell, here it is. So I'm going to sing It's a Blessing You Were Born, and then you sing back to me It's a Blessing I Was Born. Whoops. It's a blessing you were born, and it matters what you do.
It matters what we do.
What you know about God,
what we know about God,
is a piece of the truth.
Is a piece of the truth.
Let the beauty you love,
beauty love,
be what you do,
be what you do,
and you don't have to do it alone.
And you don't have to do it alone.
Now we'll all sing we. It's a blessing we were born, and it matters what we do,
and it matters what we do.
What we know about God,
know about God,
is a piece of the truth,
is a piece of the truth.
Let the beauty we love,
beauty we love,
be what we do,
be what we do,
and we don't have to do it alone,
and
we don't have to do it alone. We don't have to do it alone, and we don't have to do it alone. Cha, cha, we go cha, 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 cha. Okay, well, thank you, everyone, all of you, for welcoming these new members, and I really do hope that this feels like home to you, and that it will just grow richer and deeper and more wonderful by the day. So welcome. Thank you.
And now we're going to sing more, and we'll sing out the kids and the teens and the adults who are going to come out and do a little art extravaganza together. and a little multi-generational from this big to this big. Let's sing Go Now in Peace. Go now in peace, go now in peace. Let the spirit of love surround you everywhere.
Guess we're gonna go long today.
Go now in peace. May the spirit of love surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go.
Now, while the pop-up choir comes up, cue. Let's soak in that we just welcomed 10 new members today. Isn't that wonderful? Now take a minute to think back on when you first walked in the door here. Maybe just recently, maybe decades ago. Remember what words and actions made you feel you belonged here. Then after the service, please take time to greet each other, and especially our newest members and visitors, with that same warmth, joy, and sense of welcome. And now, the pop-up choir.
That Tubman, a former slave and a conductor on the Underground Railroad. She used spirituals like this song to signal enslaved persons that she was in the area and that she would help any who wanted to escape. The pop-up choir will sing, and I invite you to join us on the refrain.
Susan and pop-up choir. Now is the time in our service where we lift those in our circle of concern into the loving embrace of this community. In a moment, I'll ring the singing bell and invite you to speak out loud the names of those you wish to celebrate, memorialize, or remember today. I would like to begin with two sorrows. UU member Sharon Dolan's mother, Maxine, just died this past week. And we'll have a celebration of her life here on May 18th. And then also Robert Latham, who some of you may remember, served for 2 years as the interim minister here back in the early 2000s. He just wrote me this week and let me know that he had chosen to go on hospice. And he said he'll probably be crossing over Jordan within the next week or so. So please remember him in your prayers. But I also have a big joy. Some of you may remember in January, we had our annual guest at your table service with Emily Stoper and Jane Facente. Finally, the numbers have come in, and you won't believe how much this congregation was able to donate to the Unitarian Universalist Service Committee. It was a whopping $7,644. Yeah. So well done, everyone. Thank you for anyone who donated, whether your donation was large or small. And watch out, next January we'll have another one. So well done, Emily and Jane. Thank you. And so now it's your turn. For all that has been spoken out loud, and for those things that may be too tender that remain in the silent sanctuaries of your heart, let us be grateful for the embrace of this beloved community. And now let's just sit together in silence for a moment on this good earth. And now, please remain seated while we sing together. Oh, we forgot to say we hold them in our care.
Oh.
So we do hold them in our care.
We hold them in our care.
We hold them in our care. And so let's sing together What Wondrous Love.
What wondrous love is this, oh
I think you'll find that the spirit of that song is what today's reflection is about. So for today, I offer you a guest essay that was published in the New York Times this last January. It was written by Sharon Brous, who is the founding and senior rabbi of Ikar, a Jewish community based in Los Angeles. And Rabbi Brous is also the author of a book I just bought and started reading, which is called The Amen Effect, Ancient Wisdom to Mend Our Broken Hearts in the World. And in the introduction to the book, Rabbi Brous articulates her vision. We who hold a dream of building a different kind of community must begin by building a different kind of community. And so to do this, we must train ourselves to show up, which is the name of the essay. A somewhat obscure text, about 2,000 years old, has been my unlikely teacher and guide for the past many years, and my North Star these last several months, as so many of us have felt as if we've been drowning in an ocean of sorrow and helplessness. Buried deep within the Mishnah, a Jewish legal compendium from around the 3rd century, is an ancient practice reflecting a deep understanding of the human psyche and spirit. When your heart is broken, when the specter of death visits your family, when you feel lost and alone and inclined to retreat, you show up. You entrust your pain to the community. The text, Midot Tutu, describes a pilgrimage ritual from the time of the Second Temple. Several times each year, hundreds of thousands of Jews would ascend to Jerusalem, the center of Jewish religious and political life. They would climb the steps of the Temple Mount and enter its enormous plaza, turning to the right en masse, circling counterclockwise. Meanwhile, the brokenhearted, the mourners, and here I would also include the lonely and the sick, would make this same ritual walk, but they would turn to the left and circle the opposite direction, every step against the current. So let's see. And each person who encountered someone in pain would look into that person's eyes and inquire, what happened to you? Why does your heart ache? My father died, a person might say. There are so many things I never got to say to him. Or perhaps my partner left. I was completely blindsided. Or my child is sick, we're awaiting the test results. Those who walked from the right would offer a blessing. May the Holy One comfort you, they would say. You are not alone. And then they would continue to walk until the next person approached. This timeless wisdom speaks to what it means to be human in a world of pain. This year you walk the path of the anguished. Perhaps next year it will be me. I hold your broken heart, knowing that someday you will hold mine. I read in this text many profound lessons, two particularly pertinent in our time when so many of us feel that we are breaking. First, do not take your broken heart and go home. Don't isolate. Step toward those whom you know will hold you tenderly. And on your good days, the days when you can breathe, show up then too. Because the very fact of seeing those who are walking against the current, people who can barely hold on, and asking with an open heart, tell me about your sorrow. This may be the deepest affirmation of our humanity, even in terribly inhumane times. It is an expression of both love and sacred responsibility to turn to another person in her moment of deepest anguish and say, "Your sorrow may scare me, it may unsettle me, but I will not abandon you." I will meet your grief with relentless love. We cannot magically fix one another's broken hearts, but we can find each other in our most vulnerable moments and wrap each other up in a circle of care. We can humbly promise each other, "I can't take your pain away, but I promise you won't have to hold it alone." Showing up for one another doesn't require heroic gestures. It means training ourselves to approach, even when our instinct tells us to withdraw. It means picking up the phone and calling our friend or colleague who is suffering. It means going to the funeral and to the house of the mourning. It also means going to the wedding and to the birthday dinner. Reach out in your strength. Step forward in your vulnerability. Err on the side of presence. Small, tender gestures remind us that we are not helpless, even in the face of grave human suffering. We maintain the ability, even in the dark of night, to find our way to one another. We need this, especially now. And here's the second lesson from that ancient text. Humans naturally incline toward the known. Our tribes can uplift us, order our lives, give them meaning and purpose, direction and pride. But the tribal instinct can also be perilous. The more closely we identify with our tribe, the more likely we are to dismiss or even feel hostility toward those outside it. One of the great casualties of tribalism is curiosity. And when we are no longer curious, when we don't try to imagine or understand what another person is thinking or feeling, or where her pain comes from, what happens is our hearts begin to narrow. We become less compassionate and more entrenched in our own worldviews. Trauma exacerbates this trend. It reinforces an instinct to turn away from one another rather than to make ourselves even more vulnerable. And there's another important lesson from that ancient text. On pilgrimage, those who enter the sacred circle and turn left when nearly everyone else turns right are grieving or unwell, but the text offers that there is another who turns to the left. The person sentenced to ostracization. In Hebrew, the menuda. Ostracization was a punishment used sparingly in ancient times. It only applied to people who believed to have thought serious harm to the social fabric of the community. And basically, the ostracized were excommunicated. They had to distance themselves from their colleagues and loved ones. They were not counted in a prayer quorum, and they were prohibited from engaging in most social interactions. And incredibly, they too were invited to enter that sacred space. They too were asked, "Tell me, what happened to you? What is your story?" And they too were blessed. This is breathtaking. The ancient rabbis asked us to imagine a society in which no person is disposable. Even those who have hurt us, even those with views antithetical to ours, must be seen in their humanity and held with curiosity and care. We desperately need a spiritual rewiring in our time. Can you imagine a society in which we learn to see one another in our pain and to ask one another, "What happened to you?" Imagine that we hear one another's stories, say amen to one another's pain, and even pray for another's healing. I call this the amen effect. Sincere, tender encounters that help us forge new spiritual and neural pathways by reminding us that our lives and our destinies are entwined, because ultimately, it is only by finding our way to one another that we will begin to heal. So that was from an ancient Jewish text. We had as a minister here many years ago, Reverend Rob Eller Isaacs, who composed a beautiful litany of atonement, which we are now going to do as part of our service. It's a musical response to the beautiful reflection that was written by Rabbi Brous. So Sarah and I will take turns reading the words, and then you will see your part is to sing, "We forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love." It goes like this.
We forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
Will you sing that?
We forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
Oh no, actually it's up here, it's on the slides. For remaining silent when a single voice would have made a difference.
We forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
For each time that our fears have made us rigid and inaccessible,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
For each time that we have struck out in anger without just cause,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
For each time that our greed has blinded us to the needs of others,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
For the selfishness which sets us apart and alone,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
For falling short of the admonitions of the Spirit,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again.
For losing sight of our unity,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again in love.
For those and so many acts, both evident and subtle, which have fueled the illusion of separateness,
we forgive ourselves and each other, we begin again.
There's a Hebrew prayer sung during Passover called Dayenu, which means it would have been enough. It speaks to the many blessings God bestowed on the Israelites enslaved in Egypt thousands of years ago, freeing them from slavery, helping them to escape, feeding them manna as they wandered through the wilderness, and many more. Each one of the blessings they received would have been enough to be grateful for, and yet there was one more, and then one more. Dayenu reminds us to be aware of and grateful for the many, many blessings and gifts we receive. Today, for our ingathering of new members, if we had only had one person to welcome, that would have been enough. But look at our 10 new members. If we didn't have our own building to hold this celebration in and had to borrow a space, that would have been enough. But here we are in this beautiful sanctuary that our church ancestors built for us. For us. Those people showed up, just like our new members have shown up today, and they did the work, and we in turn do our work for those who come next. Our lives are the results of many blessings, small and large, given and received, each one enough in itself. And yet, there is always one more, Dayenu. As we pass the baskets, think about what you have been given and how you can give to our future. If this is your first time, please feel free to let the basket pass. Your presence is gift enough.
The pop-up choir is going to sing Shalom Haverim. We're going to sing it a number of times, and then we're going to invite you to join us in a round. Reverend Laurel and Sarah will lead this side. I'll start you off. The pop-up choir and this side will sing the next part of the round. I will tell you when it's time to come in. I hope that you will join us.
Now we'll say together the words to bless our offering to the word
of the church, which is weaving in a tapestry of love we call community. We dedicate ourselves and these our offerings.
Thank you, Papa. Now our final hymn, number 347, Gather the Spirit, please.
Rise in body or spirit. And we'll sing one more song together. And thanks to Susan for doing double duty today.
Thank you.
you want to remain standing while we extinguish our chalice? In the words.
In the words of, there we go. In the words of Nizar Kabani, Syrian poet, light is more important than the lantern, the poem more important than the notebook. And so we extinguish this chalice, but not the light of hope.
Want to face each other? We are all wounded healers, all of us. And I think that we agree with Rabbi Brous that if we would like to see a different kind of world, where we need to begin is by building a different kind of community. And I think that is what unites us in a nobler world, a noble vision that we have here at First Unitarian. And so let us all say a line, if you would repeat it after me. May we accept life's gifts.
May we accept life's gifts.
With grace and gratitude.
With grace and gratitude.
And use them to bless the world in the spirit of love.
And use them to bless the world in the spirit of love.
So we are pretty ambitious here with this noble vision in downtown Oakland. So let us now go celebrate with a potluck. And we do have a cake to celebrate all of our new members and to welcome you with sincerity and enthusiasm to this community. May it be so.